Hey, well, go to Isaiah chapter 64, verse 1. On your gadget, on your whatever, on if you got a real Bible like this with actual print. I know this is a rare thing anymore, but anyhow, you got notes, take them out, all right? Just want to kind of ride and talk about the presence of God, amen? And as you're doing that, as you're getting to Isaiah 64, I want to tell you, every time we gather, it's our heart at Life Center is for people to encounter the presence of God. Do you know that? Every time we have a meeting here, whether it's five people in the furnace, two people in the furnace, or, you know, 1,000 people out here, we want people to encounter the presence of God. Why? Because all it takes is one moment with Him, right? We sing it all the time for every chain to break, everything to change. All it takes is one moment with God. And that's why we love being in His presence. That's why I love it. When trying to close today, we just want to hang out and stay in His presence. And not that we're in His presence here, but there's something supernatural with worship that we love it. It's sometimes tangible. You can feel the tingling. How many people get that? I'm one of those, like, I want to feel His presence and know He's real. Amen? So Isaiah chapter 64, verse 1 says, "Oh, that you would rend the heavens." You guys know this? "Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down." Now stop there. Don't read anymore. Look at me. Okay? We're going to just talk about it. He's talking about having an experience with Him. The prophet's saying, "Oh, that you would come into our midst and be with us." What do you mean? I'm talking about, there's a number of things here that he's talking about experiencing an undeniable, tangible encounter with God. Are you there? And that's what he sets the stage and says, "Oh, that you would come down." And then he goes on to talk about these verses. Okay? First time I encountered the presence of God, I went to a church. I went to a church where my brother John was at and Patty was at, and I probably told you guys this before. And Patty's, you know, up front with a million-string guitar, 12-string guitar leading worship, and she and another lady were staring at the ceiling. I'm like, what are they looking at? You know, it totally freaked me out because I had not grown up in that culture, okay? And I thought a lot of people were very strange, coming up and giving me hugs, calling me brother, and I'm like, I'm not your brother, man. And they were just different. Different in a good way, all right? Anyhow, freaked me out. However, in the middle of it, I couldn't deny some kind of atmosphere I was experiencing that I'd never experienced before, okay? Were they a little off that I thought? Maybe, but I thought, these are good people. They're like the real good people, whatever that means to you, all right? At the time, that's what I thought. Like, great, you guys are involved in a really good thing, okay? Anyhow, the next time I experienced the presence of God and encountered the undeniable presence of God, I was sitting in a hospital bed. I was in traction for months, got in a horrible car accident, broke all the bones on the left side of my body, took out my spleen, they put a sheet over me, I said I was dead. That's the short version. Anyhow, the long version, I spent months sitting in traction, not being able to move. So I got a letter written to me from my older sister who began to explain to me the gospel, and began to share with me how God loved me, that He cared about me, that He had a plan for my life, that I'm not have a wasted time. And I'm telling you, I got overwhelmed by the presence of God. Not just for a few hours, it was weeks where I just wept. You know, the nurses kept saying, "Are you okay?" I'm like, "I'm great. I'm just wonderful." And I was encountering the presence of God so much. It was amazing because I couldn't move and do anything. So it was actually a perfect place. God's like, "I got you more than you know." Ooh, did He really? And yeah, totally amazing. However, why am I saying that? Because the presence of God is something that's absolutely amazing. Now go back to Isaiah chapter 64, verse 1. And he says, and he goes down and he shares a few verses here about what happens when the presence of God shows up. Now, back in July, I think it was July 1st, I talked about the things that attract the presence of God. This is part two to that. I don't know if you're really tracking all those things spoke around here. So he says, back to verse 1, that the mountains might quake at your presence. What do you mean, Bryan? I'm talking about the mountains of difficulty that are wrecked in His presence. Okay? I believe God can level things in his presence that we can't do and move in our own strength, our own ability. Okay? Are you there? I mean, He comes and just changes the landscape in our lives. All right? And I believe sometimes the mountains, more than anything, the mountain is us. If I would like to just start with that. Because I find out when I'm in His presence and His tangible presence, overwhelming corporate presence, or I'm my own little devotional life by myself in my sunroom floor, that God comes and talks to me about me first and deals with my issues. Does that make sense? Like, hey man, I'm making the crooked places straight in my heart, in my soul, in my thinking, in my perspective. That's the most powerful thing that can happen. But I believe He does this. He wrecks us in a good way, all right? Are you with me? Come on. And I believe sometimes He leads us to speak to the mountains in our own lives, all right? I've experienced this more and more because when we're in the presence of God, there's something supernatural and it's scriptural where the presence of God came upon His disciples in Acts and says they're filled with the Holy Spirit and they were given boldness to speak, boldness to share, boldness to do life where they are intimidated before. Does it make sense? It's so awesome when this happens and I find myself speaking to mountains in my life or things that appear to be mountains coming out of the presence of God. I'm like, no, this will no longer intimidate me anymore, all right? Come on, so I want to ask you today, what are the mountains in your life? What are those things that are intimidating you, all right? Just ask yourself, what are those things? There's a lot of them there, okay? Mark 11, 23 says, "Speak to the mountain that it be cast into the sea." I thought, God, we need to do this, all right? I remember graduating college, and I had massive student debt. At that time, seemed like massive, not compared to today's students. Anyhow, I came out, and I remember being intimidated by this thing that appeared to be a mountain in front of me. I remember getting before the Lord, and God speaking to me and saying, address this mountain. And I had moved like three or four times finishing college and finally got settled. And FIA, who was the education assistance agency that launched all the loans, you know, they had lost my address. So I stopped getting bills. So I literally called FIA. I felt like God's like, call him. I'm like, go after this thing. But it was boldness. See how it affected me? This is the littlest thing to you, but it was huge in my life at that time. 23 years old. I'm like, I have all this money I owe, and I don't have a job, and I'm working at this church for nothing. Not this church, another church. Working at this church. You know, anyhow, this is the way it was. And I was totally into it, 100%, like I am now. And I remember calling FIA, and they're like, excuse me? I said, yeah, I'm calling to call. I need to pay back my loans. You've lost my address. I'm not getting any more bills. Lady's like, hey, no one's ever done this before. Called us and said, you've lost my address. Please send me a bill. Like, shut up. Are you like a crazy person? You know, she didn't say those words, but I know that she was thinking. But I said, no, I want to do this, man. I want to pay this thing off. I want to make sure I make it right. Do you understand the different attitude? Before, I was in fear. How am I going to pay you? How am I going to take care of this? That changed all because of his presence. Do you understand that? Come on. Don't let the mountains, the things intimidate you. Come on, what are the mountains? What are the things that appear to be massive difficulties in your life right now? Persistent sickness, financial burden, like I just spoke of. Come on, habitual sin. Come on, a broken relationship, a prodigal son or daughter. It could be a huge mountain in your life. Those are huge, okay? I'm not lessening, I'm just saying you need to speak to those mountains, declare them, because God can change the whole landscape. Do you know that? Come on, an addiction. Maybe you have an addiction this morning. I'm telling you, I have faith to see the addiction broken. I had a roommate finishing college, got totally set free in a moment. In a moment, it was supernatural. Since that point, I have total faith to pray for people to be broken addictions. And it could be addiction to social media, okay? Or addiction to TV or something that seems frivolous, but it's sucking your soul, okay? Oh, well, I'll just let that one stay out there. Okay. All right. So we sing it all the time. I'll see you move. Come move the mountains, right? I believe you'll do it again. We sing it and sing it. Let's apply it in our lives, all right? Let's just not sing it. Let's see the reality of this happen, all right? Secondly, when you encounter his presence, he wipes out the dead areas of our lives. What does that say? Look at verse 2. We're back in Isaiah 64. You guys there? We're going to stay there for a little bit. Isaiah 64, verse 2. As fire burns up the brushwood. Doesn't that sound intense? Brushwood. I just like saying that word, right? He removes the needless areas of our spiritual lives, doesn't he? Come on, these needless dead things. Farmers say a typical vine has like 50 to 60 shoots. After they're pruned, it only has like 5 shoots. And they found out the rest were not life-giving, and only 5 are life-giving. I think likewise in our same, very much in our own lives, there's lots of dead stuff in our lives that takes up a lot of space or a lot of, you know what I mean, like bandwidth that doesn't need to take up any bandwidth. Do you understand that? And I believe when we're in his presence, he deals with that. Like, hey, let that go. Let that go. Don't give your time to that. Don't give your soul to that. He's always adjusting my heart in those situations. I believe it's one of the most powerful things that happens when in his presence. But he burns these up. Do you know that? God talks about himself being a fire in so many ways in scripture. 3 huge ones, and I'll just go through them really quickly. He talks about he's a refiner's fire. Malachi 3:2. You guys are familiar with this. He comes like a refiner's fire. I love what it says in Hebrews chapter 12. He is our God is an all-consuming fire. That's one of my prayers all the time. God, consume it all, man. Take me. I don't want just part of me burning. I want it all right? And this last one is Titus 2:14. Talks about he is a purifying unto himself a peculiar fire, a purifying fire. What does that mean? He's cleansing us. Isn't that awesome? I love when I get in his presence and I feel I'm being washed, I'm being cleansed. How many people felt that this morning in the middle of worship? I just like, that's always my prayer. God, wash over my soul. Wash over the stuff in my life that's not like you, that I've given my soul to, my thoughts to. God, cleanse me from that. Isn't that good? Come on, the prophet said it. God, take the coal, cleanse my lips. Create in me a clean heart. Those are prayers that are offered in his presence and we can do them all the time. Isn't that awesome? Now look, that's just one part of when he burns away all the dead stuff. I think that happens in a moment. And I believe the greater part is when he's doing that, he's releasing new life into us all the time. Because when the vine's pruned, man, there's life that shoots into those 4, 5, or 6 vines that are left, the buds, and releases much more strength to them. I think the same thing happens in our own lives. Do you know that? Come on, he restores our soul. I believe this happens. He releases newness of life. I love David gets up all the time and says, God, you're making all things new. And I believe he's doing that all the time with us. How many people have experienced that? Newness of life. It's addicting to be in God's presence because there's always newness of life. It's so awesome. It's the best. Charles Nam modeled this because they get in God's presence and they're not aging. They're just like, we're going to go on. It's so awesome. It's wonderful. It's like, okay, I got to stay in the presence of God, all right? You with me? Come on. So many have been healed in his presence. He releases life. As we heard from Lewis this morning, man, God's presence overshadows people and they get healed. That's what we want to see. It happen all the time, all right? Isn't this good? Are you guys okay? A few more of these? Thirdly, in his presence, he restores our passion. Look at 64, verse 2. Isaiah 64, verse 2. As fire causes water to boil. I believe in his presence, he moves us from lukewarmness to a place of passion. Man, I don't want to be lukewarm because Jesus said that's a lot of, you know what I mean? Hockaloogie, whatever you want to call it, throw up, spit up, whatever. Boot, whatever the words you use for it. But that's, I don't want to be that. I want to be like fire or cold, all right? Some people are grossed out right now. That's right. Hopefully that grossed you out. You don't want to be like that, all right? Come on, I believe in his presence. He burns into us a passion. What do you mean, Bryan? A love, a passion, an excitement, a devotion, a new zeal that's given to us on a regular basis when we're in his presence. Isn't that good? Come on. So many guys in the Bible had burning passion. You just read the Bible and I get totally stirred by Joshua and Caleb. These guys stayed in the prayer tent when they came out. They said, come on, man, we're the giants. We'll take them. They said, we are more than able to go up and take the land. That's what the presence of God does. It affects us in that way. Isn't that powerful? How many people need that? To look at some giants like, hey, man, I'm going to take them, all right? Guys like Nehemiah, he saw beyond the rubble, he saw beyond the destruction, and he had a passion to see the city of God rebuilt and restored. That's what I want to see. If you're in the midst of rubble, I'm telling you, God can rebuild and restore your life. He did it in mine. He's done it in a whole bunch of people in this room. Isn't it good? Come on, Paul had a passion to see the known world come to Christ. He had a passion. He said, I want to see everything. Nothing could quench this passion in his life. Come on. I mean, he was brutalized. He wrote stuff that was crazy sitting in prison. No betrayal, no stretching. He imparted passion, I believe, to everyone that had any time with Paul. I believe he imparted a passion to him. You know that? He said stuff like, press towards the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Like, in prison. Hello? That's seriously motivating to me, all right? I'm not sitting in a dungeon, are you? Oh, I'm tired today. Well, just read the Bible and get impassioned a little bit. Hello? Paul will wake you up or snap you back to normal. It's normal in God, all right? He taught them zeal. Isn't that great? You read this stuff, you're like, man, he's passionate to the point of losing his life. I have not been passionate, that passionate. Have you? That's challenging for me, all right? Come on, there's so many people in the Bible, but there's a ton of people in church history that displayed the passion for God. This guy named George Whitfield, you guys know this guy? The great awakening evangelist. He utters words, says, give me souls or I'll die. I'm like, really? Really? I haven't prayed that prayer today, have you? Give me souls or I'll die. That's a serious passion, isn't it? It's so awesome, man. How about the guy named Henry Martin? This is the guy that Anglican missionary to India. The first time he puts his feet on the soil of India, he says, now let me burn out for God. I'm like, wow. I'm like, I make a trip to India. I'm tired. I want to get a hotel, get some rest, sleep after 20 zillion hours. He's like, let me burn out for God. It's like, dear Lord, we need that kind of passion, don't we? Holy Spirit of God, release that in our lives, all right? I'm serious. Come on. These are words of passion from people that have been in his presence. Let his presence consume our lives. Amen? Come on, and I believe we, the church, can contain this element of, I don't know, whatever you call it, contagious intensity that affects everything around us in a good way, all right? Because we're set on fire by the Holy Spirit, all right? Next, when we encounter his presence, God brings victory. Look at Isaiah 64, 2. It says, to make your name known to your adversaries. He brings victory. What do you mean? He's making his name known to our adversaries. What do you mean? He's doing what we can't do for ourselves. What's your worst enemy? Come on, what's your worst enemy? Fear, depression, anxiety? Come on, worry, which is just a subset of fear, bitterness or sickness? Do you understand that? Come on, I believe enemies are those things that attack you. What's been attacking you in your life right now, right in this season? Ask yourself, what's been attacking you? Come on, man. I want you to wake up and get this. Do you understand this? Come on, what's been defeating you? So when I ask myself, oh man, I'm overcome by that. The Bible says, whatever a man is overcome by, he's enslaved to. I don't want to be enslaved to any of that. Ugh, whatever. Do you understand that? It's a different deal. God says, I'll make my name known to your enemies. That's pretty powerful. Isn't it good? When you understand the enemy has no power over you, that changes your whole concept of life. Remember, I was young in college, got baptized in the Holy Spirit, and read in Romans 7, I think it's chapter 6, sin no longer has dominion over you. It was a revelation to me as I'm brushing my teeth after a devotion. I came unglued. I'm like, oh, this stuff doesn't have any more power. the way I trained my flesh to party, do this, doesn't have any more strength in my life. It was broken in that moment when I got that revelation. Do you understand that? Lust, it won't rule you, man. Do you understand that? Fear won't intimidate you any longer. It's so awesome. It's by getting in his presence and knowing this stuff, okay? Am I going too fast? We're not. Keep going, all right? Next thing that happens in his presence, the impossible becomes a reality. All of this is impossible becoming a reality. But Isaiah 64:3 says, when you did some awesome things which we did not expect. When you did awesome things which we did not expect. Isn't that great? I love that. That's the way it's New American Standard. Things that we thought were impossible before, what happens? They're made possible because God's presence has come and he's doing awesome things in our lives and our hearts. Isn't that good? Come on, I love it when the goodness of God takes place when we least expect it. Do you know that? How many people have experienced that? You weren't even expecting it. I had a family come up to me after the first service, talked about, they just got a massive testimony of a first fruits prayer that they offered back in first fruits. And we're in almost October, right? Or September. And they offered it in February. They said, man, this thing came through 2 years ago. They prayed, they let this thing go. And they said, God, you got to do this because we can't do anything about it. Totally big check came in the mail and they're like, ah! They're like, we just got to show you. This was written down on our first fruits. I was like, come on. They least expected it. They just kind of wrote it off. Isn't that good? Well, I love this happens when God shows up. Acts chapter 12. You guys are familiar with this. They get a hold of Peter and they put him in prison. But first Herod arrests, gets James and they decapitate him. And according to what the Bible says, that pleased the Jews. Really? Pleased the Jews that they cut off his head. So he grabs a hold of Peter and arrests him and put him in prison. Remember that? Do you know that? And he's guarded by a bazillion guards. And he was just about to deal with them that night. And what happens? An angel shows up. Unexpectedly. So much that Peter's like, hey, what's going on here? The doors are open. Let's make a run for it. Like, seriously, that would freak you out, wouldn't it? Come on. I'd be like, oh, okay, all right. So good, come on. But I believe some of us are in impossible situations right now in our lives. I'm telling you, maybe you feel locked up and chained down and there's no way out. I'm telling you, God will make a way out for you. Do you understand that? I'm telling you, he's done it in so many people's lives and we read all about it. But I think our prayer all the more should be, God, let your angels show up in power to unlock the things we can't unlock. Amen? Come on. Another thing about his presence. God moves on behalf of the one who waits. That's what it says in verse 4. Yeah, I'm not even changing that. Isaiah 64, verse 4, we're still there. And he acts for the one who waits. Isn't that good? He acts for the one who waits. There's this promise for those that are waiting and lingering and watching in his presence. And you can do this all by yourself in your dorm room, okay? Do you understand that? Or all by yourself, or do it here all by yourself with 1,000 other people. But linger in his presence. We're in his presence. And what happens? Well, I believe we're stirred to take hold of the promises of God, aren't we? Come on, all the promises of God are yes and amen. Heidi got stuck there last week, didn't she? She stayed there. It was like 3 songs earlier. She's like, she never got by that one. Like, we'll just stay right there. She's grabbed a hold of the promises. Come on. Isaiah 40. Check out Isaiah 40, okay? I know we're switching gears. We'll come back. Isaiah 40. This is for those particularly over the age of 50, and I read it daily, all right? You know where I'm going with this? Isaiah 40, verses 28 through 31. Come on. Got a few amens. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired. Isn't that good? His understanding is inscrutable. He gives strength to the weary. Anybody there? Come on. And in him who lacks might, he increases power. The youths grow weary and tired, and vigorous young men will stumble badly. That's what I saw them happen when I was running that triathlon. They're like stumbling beside me and I'm passing. I'm thinking, okay, yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. They'll mount up with wings like eagles and they will run and not get tired. They will, what's the last part say? They'll walk and not grow weary. I love that, don't you? Come on, so good. So many things are happening in his presence, guys. We love the presence of God. But I encourage you today, man, figure out the way to entertain the presence of God all day long. In your everyday life. I got a hold of a book years ago called Practicing the Presence of the Lord. It's an old book. It changed my life. Like, God, I can live in this place where we're communing with you on a regular basis all throughout our time. Isn't that good? So much takes place. Just to review, he shakes things up. He changes things. He levels the mountains. Come on. Removes the dead areas of our lives. Makes the impossible become a reality. Isn't that good? He works on behalf of those who wait on the Lord. Can I give you one more scripture here? I know it's a whole other sermon, we're at 12:28, but I gotta share because it's just burning in my heart. Philippians chapter 4, verse 9. That's a really, really good thing. And I got this, I know, I was working out the other morning and this thing just went into me. And I was riding on a bike and I thought, ah! And you know how you get I was like, who said that? You know how you hear the audible voice of God sometimes that shake you at the most unexpected times. But Philippians chapter 4 says, Philippians 4 verse 9, what you've learned, what you've received, what you've heard and seen in me, practice these things. And I felt him challenging me. He says, what have you learned in my presence? What have you heard in my presence? What have you received in my presence? What have you seen in my presence? And I won't camp here, but the last part he really begins saying, what are you learning now in my presence? What are you learning in my presence? It became so active and current. It wasn't something like I learned that a few years ago. I've learned that growing up, and I have the whole bunch of stuff here I listed and shared with the first service, but I'm not gonna do that. But I remember really the challenging part is, what are you learning now? What are you learning now that keeps me current with him? Like, God, I'm in this relationship, you know, I'm learning now. What am I receiving now from you, Lord? There's a whole bunch of stuff we received. We received a gift of righteousness. We received him, the gift of the Holy Spirit. I love what Todd White said, you know, gifts are given, fruit is grown. There's a big difference, isn't there? I thought, I'll take that one, man. But there's certain things that have been given to us. We didn't deserve it. We don't earn it. And we sing it all the time. But God, he just gave them to us. And we need to learn how to be good receivers. If you like me, I'm not a good receiver. I'm learning to receive. All right? But what am I learning now? I'm learning to listen. I'm learning to linger in his presence. I'm learning to just not jump to conclusions when the presence of God is so powerful. Oh, no, we better close. No, we're just going to hang out and enjoy the presence of God. I got to hurry and do that. Maybe, do you really have to go do that? Or could you just stay another moment longer in his presence? I'm learning to listen. Anybody learn to listen besides me? After 30 years of being married, I'm starting to listen to my wife. That's good. Thank you. Thanks for your patience, long-suffering, endurance. I had another 1,000 things there, right? Come on. Are you there? What are you receiving? So good here. And I'm in a place I'm receiving wisdom now. I've got a lot of knowledge. I know a lot of the word, but how do I apply that in people's lives to help them? How do I apply it in my own life to live a life that shines his glory? Are you there? Come on. So good. Receiving strategies. What are you hearing? Man, I'm hearing the sound of a church rising up with power. I don't know about you. Changing the world. Come on. I'm hearing a world that's desperate for an encounter with God. Just watch the news for 10 minutes, the evening news. You get like, the world is desperate for our Savior. And we've got this Savior in our lives. It's so good. Come on. What am I seeing? I'm seeing people come to God like I've never seen people come to God before. It's exciting, isn't it? I'm seeing God shake things up and assemble things for this massive people come and get swept into the kingdom. More than anything, I'm seeing a young generation rise up with boldness, rise up with confidence to change the world. I don't know about you, man. I'm seeing a bunch of 25 and 30-year-olds like, I'm gonna be at the top of one of those mountains and run it with righteousness, with holiness, with fear of God. Isn't that exciting? Come on, guys. Come on, let's all stand. We're going to sing again, and then we'll close. God, we connect all around this auditorium this morning. God, we just worship you. We say, God, right here, right now, come on. We bow our hearts before you. God, we belong to you. We're not our own. God, we pray every one of us. Come on. We just pray for the person on our left that, God, we had an encounter. We have encounters with you on a regular basis, God. Encounters in your presence. Encounters with you, that the one who changes our life. Come on, the one who makes all things new. The one that moves the mountains, God. The one that does the miracles. Does the things we cannot do in our own lives, God. God, would you possess us completely, God. Burn away all the stuff that's not like you, Father God. That we would look like you and sound like you. And God, just reflect your goodness in the earth, God. God, I pray for holy encounters. Come on. I pray for encounters. Pray for the person. God, we just pray for every person in this room that have encounter after encounter after encounter. Life-changing encounters, God. God, all by themselves in their living room, in their car, or whatever they're at, God. God, we just pray for that. Holy Spirit, you're the one who does these things. Show up when we least expect it, God, I pray. God, we pray, as Charles said, we'd get downloads from the cloud, God. Day and night, God, we pray for that. Holy Spirit, thank you, thank you, thank you. God, we worship you. We thank you, Father. God, I just pray for an increased authority in your people, your increased authority in the people of Life Center, God. God, we walk in your promises. Come on. We have the boldness to declare your word over situations that look impossible, Father. I pray for this. Release authority. Those that are plateaued out, God, I pray, take them to another level. Come on. God, take them to another level, Father. God, we pray for every one of us. God, we go to that higher place. Come on, God, you're calling us higher into you, higher in a place of intimacy with you. God, deeper on our knees with you, God. We press in and know you, God. God, our time is short here. God, we want to live right while we're here, Father. Jesus, thank you, thank you, thank you. Come on, ministry team, if you're a part of the team, just come on up. We want to pray for you. If you want prayer and want someone to grab a hold of you and pray with you in agreement, man, we want to pray for you. So don't leave this place this morning without praying. If you've never had an encounter with this holy God that I'm talking about, I challenge you, don't leave this room. Don't leave this room without praying with somebody and say, man, but I want that encounter as you're talking about. Amen? Amen. We love you and bless you. Pray the Lord bless you, keep you, and make his face shine upon you. Go out, shine like him all week. Amen? Be blessed. Have a great week, church. Amen.